Hello everyone, I welcome you all to my YouTube channel. In the previous lecture, we have discussed about some of the design provisions in order to reduce the amount of stray current. In this lecture, we will study about the stray current collection system. So first we will understand why we require this SCCS, and then we will understand the two types of stray current collection system, that is earth stray current collection system and floating SCCS. So let's go ahead and start. This is your traction substation and this is your third rail or your catenary from where the rolling stock is getting supply. And these are your running rails and your return system, which consists of the return cables and return conductors from where the return current is going. And this is your fastening system, the rail fastening system. This is your track slab and deck reinforcements, and this is your utility pipeline. When the return current is going, it has to go back to its source, but due to some imperfections in the insulation, there is some leakage, and there is some leakage, so the current will enter into the track slab or the reinforcements available below, and from here the current will start moving and then eventually enter back to the running rails and go back to the source. But even after this mesh, there can be some leakage if there is low resistance path available below, and from this path also the current will try to travel and go back to its source, which can be your gas pipelines or water pipelines or other utilities. So due to this leakage of current, this location becomes anodic and corrosion starts happening from these locations whenever the current is leaving the structure. So whenever the current is leaving the structure, there the corrosion will happen. This we have discussed in lecture 1, 2 and 3. What we want, we do not want any corrosion to happen in this utilities. So in order to avoid what we do, we try to provide some design provisions which we discussed in lecture 3. Now, even after that, the stray current is leaking, then we have to make some design provisions in our system itself, that from our system, that is from our track slab or deck, the current does not leak and go to the utilities, or even if it is going, then it shall be of very minimal amount. So this is the purpose of stray current collection system. It will catch the stray current which is leaking from these running rails in this stray current collection net and not allow the current further to leak down. Now, with this aim, if we draw with a circuit diagram, so suppose this is your potential which is causing the stray current. So after this, you have your track slab once the stray current is leaking. So due to this running rail potential, stray current is getting into the system, and due to this insulation resistance, and once it is entering, it is going into the track slab. From track slab, it is going into the deck, and from here further it is going into the utility. So this is your resistance offered by track slab, by your deck and by your utility. So in order to keep the current flowing in this track slab itself and not letting it to go below, what we can do, we can reduce the resistance of this, that is, we can reduce the resistance of our track slab. So by reducing this, we will make that the current that is flowing, the stray current that is flowing, will enter into the track itself. So by reducing the resistance and by increasing the resistance here. So if you increase the resistance here, the current will not enter, will not go below. And if you reduce the resistance of RT, the current will remain here, which is what we do in case of running rails. In case of running rails, what we do, we try to provide some design provisions in order to reduce the longitudinal resistance, and we try to increase the insulation here. So this concept is followed by floating stray current collection system. So suppose this is your running rail, this is your fastening system. After this, the stray current enters into your track slab, and suppose this is your deck. In this case, you have some dedicated stray current collection rebars which I have marked in red. And these are your structure rebars marked in black, which are connected together through stirrup. Remember that the dedicated streaker and collection rebars must be directly under the running rails so that they catch most of the current and it goes within themselves. Along with this, we have this galvanized steel flat which is welded to these dedicated earth rebars or the dedicated stray current collection rebars, and from here it is connected to a dedicated stray current collection cable which is separate from the earthing cable which is running parallel to along the track. This SCCC must be an insulated cable, and from here there are some shear connectors which are connecting the track slab to the deck reinforcement. So here is your track slab and here is your deck reinforcement resistance. So what you are doing, you are trying to offer high impedance here. So by offering high impedance, you means you need to insulate here. So how you can do, either you provide an insulating sleeve or you do an epoxy paint to these shear connectors. So by doing this, what will happen? The current will come here and it will say, okay, I will flow in this path. Now the current will say, okay, let me find some other low resistance path below. So the current will see, but current cannot go from here because here it is insulated. So current will say, okay, leave it. Let me remain in this track slab itself, so I will not hurt the utilities. So this is why we provide this stray current collection system. Now, what some is the drawback of this floating stray current collection system is that you are having around hundreds and thousands of shear connectors. Suppose your section is of 50 kilometers or 100 kilometers of metro you are building, and these shear connectors will be in millions. So what will happen in case you are not able to inspect, because definitely it is impossible to inspect all the shear connectors and test the insulation of them. In case you are not having proper insulation at some locations, so what will happen? There will be some imperfection and the stray current will start leaking from there and it will enter into the deck and further it will go to the utilities. So what will happen here is that only at those locations, only at the failure locations which we call as hotspots, the stray current will enter and most of the current will be flowing from there and entering into these utilities, causing corrosion at that locations only. So in order to avoid this, there is another type of stray current collection system available, which is earthed. In this case, what we are having is that these are your running rails fastening system and this is your structure rebars along with the dedicated stray current collection rebars. What we do here, we try to weld all of them together in order to create a low impedance mesh. So suppose the track slab is of 5 meters, there can be lot of stair ups. So at least at one, we need to weld. We try to weld all the dedicated rebars along with the structure rebars. If not possible, then we are providing similarly here, like we are doing wire mesh. Here also we provide wire lashes in order to connect everyone together. Then again, similar to here, we are providing a galvanized steel flat which is welded to these rebars. And here we are not providing any SCCC, that is stray current collection cable. Here these rebars are connected directly to the earth or the earthing cable. This earthing cable is connected to the earth at every station. Every station is having their own earth mat. So this cable is getting connected to those earth mat system or these earth grid. And the shear connectors which were creating insulation between the track slab, between this track slab resistance and this deck, we had some shear connectors which were creating insulation. But here what we do, we do not provide any insulation. No need to provide any epoxy paint or sleeve. So what will happen? You will say, okay, if you are not providing, then the current will leak. Yes, the current will leak in this case. But what will happen is that at every location there will be some leakage. So if you are providing millions of parallel path, so suppose this is your parallel path, if you are providing lot of parallel path, then some small amount of current will be going. So if suppose this is 5 ampere and you have provided 5 paths, so 1 amp will be going in each. Whereas if you are providing 5 ampere current and only one path, which is your hotspot, and other are properly insulated, or let us suppose there are two parts where the shear connector got, where this insulation got broken. In that case, suppose 5 amps is leaking, so 2.5 will go here and 2.5 will go here. So in this case, you are reducing the amount of current entering through the shear connectors to deck reinforcement at every location, whereas you are causing, in case of failure, lot of current to be flowing through it. So in this case, corrosion is more possible at hotspots, whereas here you are creating lot of hotspots, but this hotspot cannot be a hotspot because the current is very low. So that is why we generally prefer the earth stray current collection system, but it depends upon system to system or metros to metros which one they prefer. But as per experience, it is found this system is to be better compared to the floating system. Now, in case of the complete structure, I have drawn this for complete structure. In this, I have made it for the earth stray current collection system. So we are having SEC, that is your structural earth cable. Now the question arises how the connection is there. So in this case, this structural earth cable is also connected to the handrails or the brackets, the cable trays. Along with that, it is connected to the equipments like comm equipments or signaling equipments along the path or MEP equipments. To all of that, this earth cable is getting connected. Apart from that, we are having earth terminals here below at the viaduct or the deck, and we are having earth terminals at the pier cap. Now, as these two structures are separated, we provide a dedicated earth cable, which is 70 square mm copper cable. And then we have dedicated earth rebars inside the column or the pier, which are generally two in number with 16 mm dia. And here we are having an earth terminal in order to measure the voltage drop, which I'll make you understand here later. Then these earth rebars are going inside into the piles, and from here it is getting earthed. Now we require minimum two in order to have redundancy, but it can be four or higher number of rebars, dedicated earth rebars. It depends upon IEC 62305-3. As per this standard, it states that for individual column, the resistance shall be 10 ohms. So generally with two dedicated rebars, you will achieve this resistance. It depends upon the soil resistivity. It does not depend whether you are using stainless steel rebars or mild steel rebars or copper, or even if you choose gold, it does not matter. It depends upon the soil resistivity, which we have discussed in my earthing bonding lecture series. So if you are not able to achieve 10 ohms, then what you can do, you can provide some mesh here or some earth pits here and then connect it to the dedicated earth rebars which are coming here, so that overall resistance will fall below 10 ohms. This is only if you are not able to achieve. Now, why this is 10 ohms? It is as per this lightning standard, because in case of lightning strike, then all the current, lightning current, will move from here and go back to the earth. Now, why 16 mm dia? The dia, why shall it be 16 mm? It can be higher, depends upon the resistance, but it cannot be lower than 16 mm. Even if you are getting resistance of suppose 0.5 ohms or 1 ohms, then you cannot say that, okay, I'll provide 2 mm rebar or 5 mm rebar or 10 mm rebar. It is not correct. You have to provide minimum 16. This is as per table 6 of IEC 62305-3. This table states that for lightning protection, the minimum cross-section area, if you are using steel and round rebars, then it shall be 176 mm square. So if you calculate, it comes around 15. So we provide the next one, that is 16 mm dia. Similarly, how this is 70 square mm, again it is provided in table 6 of 62305-3 or table 1 of 62561-2. All these values are also provided in this standard. Now, in suppose you are not able to provide any earth terminal here, then what you can do, you can take this earth cable directly here and connect it to the structure earth rebar. Only in case you are not having this facility or the earth terminals available here. Then, apart from this, if I take the top view, it looks like this. So this is your first span, this is your second span. Normally a span is of around 30 to 35 meters long. So in this you have your track slabs which are separated due to some drainage and proper drainage and others, civil structures. So in this case what you do, you are having separate rebars. You need to perform continuity, you need to reduce the resistance. What you do, you provide connection to each of these track slabs for these dedicated rebars which we have seen here. And at every span or at every 100 meters, you need to connect to the structural earth cable or the stray current collection cable in case of floating system. So this is how you do the connection. Now this at every span it shall be given or at every 100 meters, it is nowhere mentioned in any of the standards, but it is as per the general practice because we need to reduce the resistance of the upper reinforcement or the track slab. We do not want the current to enter below to the utility, so we try to reduce the resistance as much as possible. So by providing more number of equipotential bonds, you are reducing the resistance. Now the question arises, how to select what are the number of dedicated rebars which we require, like whether we require two dedicated rebars or do we require four or do we require 8 dedicated rebars? What are the size, whether 10 mm, 16 mm, 12 mm, what is possible? It is given by NXC2 of EN50122-2. As we have understood earlier in my lecture 2 and lecture 3 that there are some design criterias in which one of them was 2.5 milliamps. The other one was this voltage, if you measure with a copper sulfate solution, it shall be lesser than 200 millivolts for the longitudinal rebar in the column. And also we have seen that for the longitudinal voltage along the one section for the rebars which we are providing here, the dedicated rebars, in order to avoid corrosion, this voltage shall be lesser than 200 millivolts. And the formula for this voltage is given by this. You can pause the video and check the formula. This formula is mainly dependent upon the current, that is the traction current flowing in these running rails, which is the return current, and it is calculated at the highest hour of traffic. And then this length is the section length, which is generally between two TSS or two traction substation. Then this is the parallel combination of the resistance of running rails. These are your running rails, and some cases you provide return conductors. So it is the parallel of those, and RS dash is your structure resistance. Now structure is your dedicated earth rebars, along with you can use these structural earth cable in order to reduce this value. And this is your characteristic length, which is given by 1 upon square root of R dash plus R plus GRE, where GRE is your track to earth conductance, which is generally 0.05 Siemens per kilometer. Now we put these values. In case your section length is higher or your current is higher, then your value will not be able to come within 200 millivolts. So in that case, what we do, we cannot play with R dash, we cannot change the section length or reduce the current. What we do, we try to play with this RS dash, which is your structure resistance. So what we do, we try to increase the number of dedicated rebars in order to reduce this value. Or you can reduce this value by increasing the size of this cable, that is your structural earth cable. Or what you can do, you can also use handrails which are connected to this structural earth cable. So your effective resistance will be now with structural earth cable, dedicated rebars and the handrail. So like that you can play with this RS dash and you will be able to achieve this value, which is lesser than 200 millivolts. Even after that you are not getting, then the standard states that this is a very conservative value. Why? Because you are choosing the highest hour of traffic, and this higher hour of traffic is normally from morning 6 to 9 or evening 6 to 9, because there are which are the office hours where the number of trains or the headway is lower. So in this case what you do, you use an operation coefficient which is K, and this will tell you the total number of trains running for 24 hours of period. So if you use this factor will come out to be around 0.5 to 0.7. So this will again reduce your value and you will be able to achieve this 200 millivolts value. This you shall only use once you are you have used all the opportunities, or you have used all the measures which were possible. Like you have provided at least four dedicated rebars of 16 mm. Your structural earth cable size is also now 185, and even handrails are not able to satisfy your equation. Then you shall go ahead with this lesser conservative approach, that is using the operation coefficient. So I hope you have understood how we design the straight current collection system, why it is required, and in the next lecture we'll be understanding more about these systems. So thank you for listening. Please subscribe to my channel, and God bless you all.